Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. Precious blood. Oh, that day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. To grace, how great a debtor, daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Good morning, everyone. We're certainly glad you're here with us today. I wish you were even closer than you are right now. I miss seeing so much of you. Now, let's just take a minute and open in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the love that we experienced when we came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, the realization that we were loved more than we could imagine, to the point that the Lord Jesus Christ dying on the cross for our sins, paying the penalty that was ours, giving us forgiveness, giving us eternal life because he rose from the dead, giving us a future of knowing that we have a spot reserved for us in heaven. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your presence with us at all times. We think of even during this pandemic, we're thankful for the fact that you care for us more than we can imagine, that you are there with us, that even though we're suffering from the effects of just being at home all the time, we pray for, especially for kids as they no longer can spend much time with friends and the interaction that they would have gotten at school. But we ask, Lord, that you would be with them. Pray for family times, and we ask that sometimes being real close, tensions get high, but we ask, Lord, that you would give calm and peace. We pray for protection from the disease. Think of some of our folks who are not well, and we commit each one to you, and we thank you for your care for them. Think of people who have lost loved ones recently, and how difficult the even maybe not even getting to say goodbye, but the funeral arrangements and things like that. And we just pray for them as well as they deal with the with that. Think of many of the workers in different ministries that their work has been curtailed because of this pandemic. But we think of others where the work has expanded. We think of Star of Hope and Patterson and the food distribution and how it went from a one day a week operation to 5 days a week. So we ask, Lord, for all of the volunteers that work there. We're thankful for them. We ask you to watch over and protect them. We pray that this ministry meeting needs of the food needs of people, that it would also be a ministry of the love of the Lord Jesus Christ and his saving grace. Pray for Joe Murphy over in Dublin and the meals that they serve each and every day. Last communication was over 300, and we're thankful for that. We pray for the workers, give them stamina to continue in serving you in that area. Lord, we pray for our personal growth as we spend time at home and maybe not interact as much. Give us the time to spend in your word and to meditate on it and study it. Pray that we would take advantage of many things that are available on the internet as well. So we just commit this time to you. We pray for Nick as he would give us a message later on. And we just, again, ask that you would touch our hearts as we go through again, starting this study in Matthew. So we commit this time and this day to you and each one of us as we fellowship from a distance. We do it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, everybody, and welcome again to, I guess, Valley Bible Chapel. And it's good to be with you. It's good to share this time together on a Sunday morning. Just a few announcements that we wanted to make and make sure that you're aware of. And these are basically just the growth between the growth groups and the prayer groups we have going on. There is something going on just about every day of the week. And so I just would want to point you to the website to take a look at the different times and perhaps the studies and the people who are heading those up to make sure that you know that these things are available for you. We'd love to see you join either a growth group or a prayer group. And for those of us who have been on those, it's been an incredibly encouraging time. So just do make sure that if you're not currently involved, seriously consider joining. It's been a very encouraging time. Another thing to just be aware of is there is an opportunity for giving, specifically food items for those who are in need during this current time of the pandemic. And so we do have a drop-off here at Valley Bible Chapel by the Awana doors. Another thing to take note of is if you are interested in volunteering your time for food distribution purposes, there is a ministry called Star of Hope who is doing that currently, and you can reach out to Mary Beth for details on that. Also, just because of the holiday weekend, we will not be having service again tonight. And also just wanted to kind of welcome all the kids who are out there, who are sitting with their parents, who are listening to the time and listening to the sermon. Just wanted to let you know that if you haven't done it already, that your current lesson, the Sunday school lesson, is going to be coming from Luke chapter 4, when Jesus teaches in the temple. And the big takeaway there is that Jesus was proclaiming to be the Messiah, which is a huge deal. So it's going to be a great study for you and your family. So I just encourage you to take a look at that and enjoy the conversation surrounding Jesus. And those are the big announcements for the week. And I just wanted to, and right now I'll pass it off to Ryan and Anna.
Could be. carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
It's good to be back up here. I think I was talking with Ariadne on this, and I don't think I've been preaching. I haven't preached since about December, so it's been a long time. So it is, it's as always a privilege to be able to preach the word. I know that I benefit immensely from my study time and my prep. So again, thankful to be here, and excited to get into Matthew. Boy, we've been going through this in our growth group, in our men's group, and it's been really encouraging. So I also want to just say, I don't know, it's been an interesting, I personally have had an interesting few weeks, despite not getting out too much. I don't know, people are kind of forcing me to think through issues I've never really had to consider. You know, the most obvious consideration at this point is how the pandemic affects our daily decisions. You know, do we go and visit this person? You know, and if we're gonna go and visit this person, who have they hung out with? Who have they contacted? Like, what's their job? You know, what's the risk here? Is it worth it? Then there's, you know, that's like kind of the nuts and bolts. And then there's the conversation of, you know, this idea of personal freedom versus the common good. So you level it up a little bit. Yeah, right, the common good. And, you know, how exactly do you define the common good? Because I don't know, we'll come to consensus on that. You know, is the common good getting people back to work? Or is it shutting down our economic system for the sake of flattening the curve? You know? Then, of course, the conversation moves into talking about government and perhaps political philosophy. So the question is, what is the role of government in this current pandemic? What is the role of government overall? And, you know, as I process these things, my question to myself, or the thing I want to come to, is how can I be balanced and biblical in my conclusions? Why? Why are you people making me think about these issues? Honestly, these are not things I love to spend time in, but they are important. And it's interesting how these ideas kind of dovetail with this study in Matthew. You know, this gospel is all about the concept of Jesus as king. The truth is, though, you know, I have very little framework for understanding what a monarchy is. Mostly because, honestly, I cannot fathom someone trustworthy enough to occupy the role of king. You know, I've also never lived under a monarch. In fact, if you were to say that word in my house, you would probably have Natalia darting around and trying to chase after a butterfly. So while I'm thankful for the system we currently have in place with this idea of checks and balances, you know, it quickly gets exposed that we need that because no leader is perfect or can see the whole picture in terms of governing. But thankfully, you know, we can build our understanding of this ideal rule, this kind of vision of perfection, of a morally perfect and all-knowing ruler by studying the Word of God. You know, and as we build this framework, it should start stirring within us a hope of longing for that time when Jesus is going to come back to reign. So let's now turn to Matthew chapter 2, where we're going to encounter a group of wise men coming from the east to worship the newborn king of the Jews. Now, looking at this narrative and tracking the events of the wise men, we can learn some really valuable lessons. So let's look now at the first half of the narrative in Matthew chapter 2, looking at verses 1 through 6. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, 'But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Now, the text says that these wise men, or magi, they came from the east. And commentators do some speculating that, you know, they may have come from either Persia or Babylonia. And the text just doesn't tell us here. But, you know, depending on where they came from, that could have been a 718-mile journey from where they're coming from to Jerusalem. And if you want to put that a little bit in perspective here, that's sort of like walking from Valley Bible Chapel all the way to South Carolina. Take a few days to get there. So you can see that these wise men or these magi, they weren't messing around in their pursuit. They were pursuing this evidence that they thought was hard evidence that revealed to them that there was a newborn king of the Jews. And, you know, just like these wise men, you should pursue any evidence you hear about the king. You know, obviously, compared to the wise men, we have a bit of an advantage. We have the Word of God as our primary source of evidence gathering about the king. We also have Google, and we also have airplanes. So I guess in that case, we win. But it wasn't the case for the Magi. So they had to pursue this evidence through the right people. You know, these Magi, they went to Jerusalem. And again, the text doesn't specify who these Magi were, but we could speculate a little bit based on how other literary sources, contemporary to Matthew's time, how they use the term Magi. We can say that they were known for their learning and wisdom. And somehow, the text reveals to us that through a star, they determined the king of the Jews was born. At this point, I have so many questions. You know, how did they connect this star to the birth of the king of the Jews? What in the world was this star? Was it a comet? Was it a planetary alignment? Was it a supernova? And, you know, again, who exactly are these Magi that are only mentioned in the book of Matthew? There's a lot of theories. There's a lot of ink spilled on these topics, but the text doesn't answer these questions. What we know for certain is that they were wise. They were not Jewish. They were seeking the newborn king of the Jews. They were led by a star, and they were also taken seriously by the Jewish leadership of the time. You know, each of these facts are meant to clue us into the fact that this was an extraordinary birth. Prominent men from a distant land, they see a star and conclude that an extraordinary king is born of the Jews. So they travel a significant distance to Jerusalem looking for answers. They were pursuing, again, they were pursuing this knowledge through the right people. Now, that brings us to this question. You know, who do we go to for clarification on the things we hear about the king? And another question is, are you one of those people? You know, that's kind of a discouraging question, because I don't know that I would consider myself a beacon of knowledge, somebody that people can come to for questions of the word. But so I guess I'm going to try to reframe that question. You know, I'll put it like this. Are you currently on a path to becoming someone who would be considered knowledgeable about the Bible? Are you currently investing your time in the word and learning more about Jesus? And let's keep this in perspective here. You know, knowledge isn't the end goal here, but knowledge is a means to a deeper relationship with God. It's kind of the thing that tills the soil for a more mature faith, a godly lifestyle, and an increased quality of worship. You know, let's not, for us here today, let's not only search out people who are knowledgeable of the King, but let's also take the steps to become those people who are knowledgeable. Now, again, the Magi were seeking the king of the Jews, so it was logical for them to go to Jerusalem first. But we quickly learn from the text that not everyone was excited about the news. Looking in verse 3 here, it reads, "When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him." You know, it's interesting here because Herod and the wise men were approaching this same bit of evidence. And they were doing it from two different perspectives. And, you know, we're going to see that both of them were interested in finding this newborn king, but they had vastly different motivations in finding him. Now, as believers in Jesus, we are wise to pursue this evidence or to pursue, yeah, the evidence with the right motivation, the right motivation. You know, Herod, when we look at him, we kind of see that he was motivated to find out more to preserve his power. And I have to imagine, based on what the text says, you know, that all Jerusalem was troubled as well, that they were aligned with him. They were the people in power, and they didn't want to see their power disrupted. Whereas the wise men were motivated to find out more in order to worship. And again, it's kind of like throws us back to us, and we can ask this question of, what do you do with the evidence of this king, of Jesus? You know, are you more concerned with how it will impede your current lifestyle than how it will impact your worship? And I guess that kind of brings up the next question, like, how could the knowledge of the king impact your life? Well, a few ways is that it could perhaps change the way you spend your time. It could change who you hang out with. It could also impact your wallet, your entertainment choices. And like, those are kind of the, I don't know, maybe they're the negative components to this that we need to evaluate. But there's also the positive ways that the knowledge of the king could impact our lives. It could certainly enlarge our view of the king, give us a better understanding of his character and nature. You know, it can also, and hopefully, create this longing for the time when Jesus comes back and does rule. And hopefully, it can also align your will to conform to the will of somebody who is so much greater than you, than me, than anybody in this world. And that's the will of God. So it's cool. Pursuing this knowledge of God can have great impact in our lives. And so we need to pursue the evidence of the king. We need to pursue it with the right people. We need to pursue it with the right motivation. And we need to pursue it in the right places. You know, in verses 4-6, we see Herod calling the priests and the scribes, and he's having them look into the meaning of this star and where this newborn king could be found. And you know, despite their motivations, the scribes and the leaders and Herod, they find truth in the word of God through the prophets. And just kind of as an aside here, isn't it just so encouraging that the word of God stands on its own? And how it's impervious to man's corruption. You know, of course, like, we can have people try and corrupt the meaning of Scripture through bad interpretation. But thankfully, God has given us minds. He's given us his word and his spirit to really fully discern truth. Well, you know, Herod's group, they find the information that the wise men are seeking. And they find it from the prophet Micah. Verse 6 again reads this, "But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Now this is where it kind of gets interesting. Well, the whole thing is interesting, but I just wanted to drill down on this a bit. Matthew, the author of this book, is doing something specific with this reference. You know, on the one hand, he's using it to kind of push the narrative forward, to see the story progress. On the other hand, he's using it to convey a larger idea to the Jewish audience, who would have automatically made certain associations from this text, from this quote. You know, like, take the example of this quote that some of us might be aware of. You know, the quote of "Aslan is on the move." Now, if you said that in conversation to me or any other fortunate person who has read the Chronicles of Narnia, it would call to mind the awesome power of God and how it's at work to kind of progress his agenda, to push his agenda forward. And what's kind of neat is that this simple five-word phrase elicits so much larger of an idea that can be clearly and efficiently communicated. And that's what Matthew is doing here. And you know what? That's what Matthew is going to continue to do in this gospel. And so he's going to use these kind of phrases that are going to bring these larger ideas of Jesus as the king. And you know what? For us, it's going to require a bit of work to figure out these broader meanings of the quotes that Matthew is going to use throughout the gospel. But in doing so, we're going to catch kind of what he's intending for the audience to understand about Jesus. So that brings us to the next thing of what would the contemporary reader of Matthew understand that we, 2,000 years later, might miss? And now just please understand that you are getting the Cliff Notes version of this. And so I want to bring you to kind of the larger context of the quote from the prophet Micah. What he's doing in the context is he's basically making the announcement to the people he's writing to that of the coming death and destruction that's going to accompany the Babylonian captivity. But as he kind of conveys to the people this captivity, he moves his message further, and he kind of then explains and follows up this message of how God is going to deliver his people from these oppressing nations. And he says how a ruler is going to come from Bethlehem. You know, as you read Micah chapter 4, verse 6 through chapter 5, verse 5, what you're going to see is a ruler who would gather the lame and the outcast, and he would turn them into a strong nation, and that he would reign in peace. Additionally, when you look at Micah chapter 5, verse 2, you know, Matthew doesn't quote this, but it's in Micah. It says, "This is a ruler whose going forth are from of old, from everlasting." And the implication here is this ruler is pre-existent. This could only point to one person, and that's Jesus. Now, it's hard, obviously, to do full justice to the level of impact this reference would have had on the Jewish readers of the time. You know, though this quote was ancient history for even them, we have to realize that they were still under the authority of a foreign power, of Rome. And yet, even though they were still under that authority, they had this hope of a deliverance to come from this ruler, this Messiah, this king. And so for us, pursuing the evidence of the king is one of the greatest investments of time you could ever make. You know, so much is said of God, of Jesus in the Word. And the evidence can, you know, the evidence of who Jesus is can be tracked down in both the Old and the New Testaments. And so I guess here's the challenge from kind of what we've been talking about. You know, let's all start to walk down this path of becoming a resource of biblical knowledge. You know, for the next generation, for these kids who are coming up, who are in Sunday school right now, because they're going to be the ones who are going to be looking to us. And, you know, let's seek out those who are mature in the faith, and let's study Scripture together. So we need to pursue the evidence we have of the King. Next, we want to respond to the evidence we have of the King. And so picking up in verse 7 here, it reads, "Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go and search carefully for the young child. And when you found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also.'" It's interesting because we now see this contrast of Herod to the Magi. And it provides us with a clear example of a proper and improper response. Now, learning from Herod, we want to make sure, or you want to make sure, that your response is not self-serving. You know, Herod wanted to know about the newborn king, but He wanted to know for his own purposes. He was interested in the location of the child for the sake of retaining power. As you'll see further in the chapter, he took some pretty drastic measures to retain his power by killing all the boys under the age of 2 in Bethlehem. And you know, for us today, thankfully we're not so, in our society, we're not seeing this level of extreme in terms of killing baby children. But there are a lot of people who are interested in knowing Jesus, but are more interested in how that will further their own pursuits. You know, perhaps it's earning favor in a community of people. Maybe it's scoring political points with a certain constituency. You know, we need to make sure that our responses to the evidence of the king is not self-serving. In verse 8, we see Herod send the wise men to search for the king. You know, we see also that Herod, he wanted to know about Jesus. He wanted to know about this king, but he didn't want to investigate for himself. You know, let's say that you were to, again, we'll use Valley Bible Chapel as a reference point. Let's say you were to take a walk down to Valley Hospital. And you go and you stop off and you say hi to my mom working in same-day surgery. You leave there and you start walking back to Valley Bible Chapel. And that would be about the distance it would take to go from Jerusalem to Bethlehem. That's not very far at all. And you know, like, he could have made that trip himself. But let's, you know, give Herod the benefit of the doubt, which we probably should never do. You know, kings don't often do things for themselves, okay? You know, they order other people to do it for them, especially, I guess, when it's not a high priority. You know, pursuing Jesus at this moment in the text was not Herod's priority. We're going to see that obviously shift in the next narrative, but how many of us fall into this category? You know, we want to know more about Jesus, but don't want to prioritize and make the effort. And a lot of us at different times, almost all of us, I would say, fall into this trap of prioritizing the wrong things. Or perhaps we find ourselves not prioritizing anything at all and dump hours of time into our screens, really doing nothing but this. A good exercise for the thumb, maybe not so much for the brain, but you know, like, I guess the point of bringing this stuff up is to kind of be reflective. You know, like, what amount of time do we devote to pursuing the king? And here's why this is important to consider. You know, we all have a fixed amount of time on this earth. And at the end of your life, I guess the question is, what do you want your timesheet to report as you hand it over to the king? You know, believers in Christ, let's prioritize getting to know our king. Make sure your response isn't like Herod's. Instead, look to the wise men and make sure your response allows you to complete the pursuit. Let's look at the experience of the Magi. You know, verse 9, it reads, "When they heard the king, they departed. And behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy." You know, the Magi's pursuit brought them exceedingly great joy. That's what the text says here, exceedingly great joy. It's kind of just saying a whole ton, like an incredible amount of joy. And just note how this was their response to simply seeing the star again. They hadn't even come to the child. It was again, their pursuit was able to continue because of the star. And there's something to be said about tracking down who Jesus is and the joy that comes from learning something new about him. There is joy in the pursuit. You know, next, verse 11 shows us the Magi's discovery brought them to generously worship. In verse 11, it reads, "And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh." You know, what a scene that must have been. I picture it similar to these like COVID birthday graduation celebrations that are happening, where these trains of people are kind of coming through this quiet neighborhood, and you have this honking and these people hanging out of their cars with signs and banging on instruments, and you see like the whole neighborhood kind of popping their heads out of the door, seeing like what is happening here? Oh, it's a birthday party. And so here in this text, we have these prominent, these wealthy men of influence who I would imagine it was like a caravan. If they're traveling 718 miles from somewhere, this was no small kind of venture. They're coming to this home of this poor couple who Mary had just given birth to this little baby boy, and they're coming to worship him, and they're offering these costly gifts worthy of a king. And it's striking to me that these wise men were able to kind of look past the external circumstances to the spiritual reality. The King of Kings had been born, and they were coming to worship him. And then, you know, the last part of this narrative, we see the Magi's obedience brought them home. Verse 12 says this: "Then, being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way." You know, it's just God's directing in this whole narrative is truly remarkable. You know, and then at the end, he continues to direct them by telling them, the Magi, he says in a dream, listen, don't go back to Herod. Avoid him. And again, it's something to take note of. They weren't swayed by the temporal powers of the day. In this case, it being Herod, but they obeyed God instead. You know, I pray that we would all have that same ability to walk by faith rather than by sight, to be obedient to God's word, and to allow that to dictate our actions and our pursuits. So what's Matthew doing here? He is telling us about the King of Kings. And as the gospel continues, we're going to see additional proofs and confirmations of Jesus as the foretold king. We're also going to see how, with the full authority of heaven at his fingertips, this king went to the cross and took on the sins of humanity, and he paid for them all. You know, just like Herod and the wise men, he has given us all a choice. We can put our faith in this king and accept his sacrifice for us for the forgiveness of sins, or we can reject him and pursue our own desires. You know, today, if you haven't put your faith in Jesus, my hope is that you would consider it. There's truly no one like Jesus, and he is worthy of your trust, your faith, and ultimately your life. For those of us who do believe in Jesus, we have a kind of a different charge today. We need to be wise, and we need to be to pursue and to respond to any evidence we have of the king. Now, here's kind of the bottom line. Do you want to be characterized as self-concerned or as someone intent on pursuing the king? You know, thank God today that we have a king who is worthy of our time, who is worthy of our attention, and is worthy of our pursuit. We can praise him this morning for that. Let's close with a word of prayer. Father, just I'm blown away by your word. I'm just so thankful of how you worked through Matthew to convey this message of Jesus as the king. And so, God, to just praise you this morning for the encouragement for myself to further pursue the evidence that you've laid out in your word of Jesus and to respond appropriately. And I praise you for how that enhances and creates a depth of worship that previously I didn't have. And God, I just pray for each one of us here today that we would all take this pursuit on together, God, that we would be able to collectively know you better and to be able to collectively worship you with more depth and more quality And we know that only comes from you. So we do ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Nick, for that excellent sermon about our response to Jesus. You know, we looked at Herod, we looked at the Magi, and we see a very drastically different response to worship. And this is the time where we're going to be breaking bread and we're going to be remembering the Lord's death and his burial and his resurrection. So if you have crackers handy or, you know, some bread and something to remember, you might want to gather that up, you know, pretty soon. What is our response to Jesus? What is worship really all about? And I've heard it explained as worth-ship. You know, what is something worth? And we understand that Jesus Christ was God. He is God in the flesh. And he lived this perfect life and died the only death that could ever remove sins once and for all. And he calls us to remember him through these very simple symbols. Probably because he knows that we have really bad memories and it would be really difficult for us to keep our mind focused on the cross. But when we think about the elements and we think about, you know, what they really mean, it calls us back to that point in human history where God redeemed us from our sins. And it's not about, you know, good works. It's not about, you know, being better and trying your best, but it's about what Jesus Christ has done for us on the cross. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, this is what Paul writes about this. He says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you will proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And that is our form of worship, not to focus on ourselves, but to focus on what God has done for each and every one of us. So let's take the bread and let's just give thanks for that right now. So Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the fact that you love us and that you care for us and that you are a God who revealed himself in ways that we wouldn't expect. You know, we think of, you know, the King of all things, the author of life, coming in this humble manner to a humble family, living a very humble life, and then teaching this very revolutionary, you know, way of living it and putting others first and putting God first and what that looks like, Lord. And we're thankful for that example, but you were so much more than an example, because we know that you were put to death. You allowed people to nail you to a cross, to mock you. And Lord, it's our sins that put you there, Lord. And you know, again, we're sorry for the things that we do, but we are so encouraged and so grateful and so thankful for the fact that you provided a way for us to have that right relationship with you. And we know that only came through the cross. So as we take this bread, Lord, we pray that we would remember that incredible price that was paid for our redemption. In your name, amen.
Okay, let's also give thanks for the cup again, which serves as a reminder of just the blood that was spilled by Jesus. And that, for those of us who haven't been to church, if you're listening, that may sound a little strange, but it's incredibly important, because the Bible teaches us that it's by his blood that our sins could be forgiven. God required sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins. And the sacrifice was previously of animals, of bulls and goats. And what Jesus came to do is he came to be the last and final sacrifice, fulfilling an old covenant and ushering in a new. And there's no more need for sacrifice anymore because Jesus was the last one. And so that's these are the things that we call to mind as we take the cup. And so let's give thanks for it. God, we recognize that we are fallen and sinful people and that we were in great need of a Savior. And this morning, we are just so thankful for the reminder of the provision for us through Jesus, that you provided him to be that last and final and perfect sacrifice. And we know that his blood was spilled so that our sins could be forgiven. And so, God, I just am thankful that it's just through faith in that finished work of Christ on the cross that the forgiveness of sins is applied to any who would believe. So, God, we do praise you for your plan of salvation, of redeeming sinners, buying them back. And it's because of these things that we just praise you this morning and give you thanks. Amen. Well, everybody, it's been a privilege to kind of just put this stuff together and to be able to worship together, even though we're apart on a Sunday morning. And just super grateful for the time. I'm thankful for each one of you. Thankful for all the times that we do get to spend together and how we get to connect, whether it's through text or phone calls or Zoom video. And for those that I haven't seen in a while, hey, it's good to, I wish I could see you. I would love to say it's good to see you. But again, it's been good. And so remember, there is no service tonight, but before we end things totally, we do have one more song that we get to hear from. All right.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in any. No power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my rent.